and it's the case of Grandpa Miguel. It's in your folder. Oh, thank you. You want to pull that sheet off? It looks like this. This is a Word document. Do you all get that? It should be on your package. It looks like a Word document. Like this one. Would you mind if I borrow it?
No.
Looks like this. It has a 2-page document. Grandpa Miguel is actually a real patient that we have. And this is the format of our clinical information. And so Grandpa Miguel is a patient X that you encounter on the emergency room. This is your first night shift as a specialist or a discipline that you are, doesn't matter. And it's July 1st of 2006. And you need to understand that for programs who have trainees, July 1st of 2006, and for your information, shouldn't go to a hospital, okay? Because July 1st is the day that all the interns and residents switch. So medical students become interns become residents become fellows become attendings. Not good. And so it's July 1st of 2006. So if you can avoid the hospital that day, that's good. the ambulance is bringing a patient who was found down at home for an unknown period. You have no idea what happened to this guy. His name is Grandpa Miguel. He was born in 1921. And he lives in Floresville, which is a little town south of San Antonio. And this is what we know of him. He has diabetes, he has hypertension, usually he's well controlled, he's been pretty functional. He has been away from his family, and he has had some small trouble with alcohol. This is the last complaint that we have in our electronic medical record. My sugars have been fine, usually 100. The holidays are always a difficult time for me because I'm not close to my family. They think I drink too much, but I have cut back a lot. I need my Viagra refill. I have a new lady friend named Mary that I met 3 months ago at a dinner party. I think she's the one. My mood is okay. You know I keep busy, and I have good friends whom I play domino 2 times a week. I have to get up to pee a lot at night, and this bothers me. I almost fell last night, and my knees gave away. What else do we know about him? He's an antidepressant. He's on diabetes medication. He's on blood pressure medication, and he takes some inhalers and vitamins and aspirin. The last encounter, he pretty much they encouraged diet and exercise on him. His hypertension was controlled, and they continued the Viagra for this, which he asked for the new relationship that he was having with this woman. So this patient is brought in a stretcher. He's moaning and keeps asking for Mary. The clerk on the front desk calls saying that there is a lady named Mary who claims to be Mr. Grandpa Miguel's girlfriend. Can she come to see him? You want her to come? Is that okay? Yes? Okay.
If he wants to. He's asking for.
You briefly meet with Mary and now know that Mr. Miguel fell in the shower and could not get up for 2 days. Mm. Mary had found him on the floor and called the ambulance. On exam, Mr. Miguel was confused and oriented only to his name. Vitals were a temperature of 102, blood pressure of 80 over 50, heart rate of 120, respiratory rate of 24. So what does those vitals mean? So he has hypertension, his blood pressure is low, what else?
His
febrile, so we may have to deal with an infection or some sort of inflammatory process. Uh-huh. What else?
He's dehydrated.
He looks dehydrated, he's tachycardic, and his blood pressure is low, so most likely. He sounds like he has been in the floor for 2 days, so that's pretty difficult. His lips are dry, and he's moaning and reaching for his legs. He seems to be in pain, but he's unable to answer further questions. A large ecchymosis. Oh, we're going to page number 2. A large ecchymosis was noted on his left flank, and his left leg was shorter than the right. X-ray showed a left hip fracture. Does this sound familiar?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we're going to talk about pain assessment and management. And we're gonna try to, fit Mr. Grandpa Miguel in this case scenario.
So we're going to discuss the multidimensional aspects of pain, describe how to evaluate and assess pain. We're going to state the risk benefits and appropriate dosing of common pain medications. And we're going to discuss non-pharmacological options for treating pain. So this is what we know about pain. Maybe you know this better than me. But pain affects millions of Americans. Please raise your hand if you have had pain in your life.
Yes.
Thank you. All right. Pain limits the activity of about 13% of the population. What this means is that 13% of the United States active population cannot work, cannot produce, and is needed to have a caregiver because of pain issues. So that's pretty bad. 9% of the population cannot care for themselves because of chronic pain, and you have experienced this from your patients and maybe from your loved ones as well. Arthritis, which is something that hurts, is the second chronic condition affecting Americans. About 15 million Americans suffer from arthritis, which is very painful. The problem is that when a patient comes to the doctor's office, the first thing we ask is, how is your blood pressure, how is your diabetes, and nice to see you because your 15 minutes are up. So arthritis is a chronic condition, right? It's very common, and it's normal that older adults have pain, correct?
Correct.
Is it normal?
No.
Good. Okay. But it is what everybody thinks. Low back affects 60 to 80% of the population at some point. And I'm sure many of you, if not all of you, have experienced low back pain. I'm certainly doing that. And of course, you know that cancer causes pain. Consequences of pain. So when someone has pain, there's definitely a component of depression, of anxiety, decreased socialization. They're not going to bingo again, or to parties again, or to family reunions. They can't carry their grandchildren because they're having pain. There's sleep disturbance, and if they are disturbed in their sleep, they're not going to think right, and eventually they will become confused. There's also an impaired ambulation, so they're going to need help, which costs money and effort from all family members. And there is an increased healthcare utilization and costs. This is all with an addressed pain program. So tell me, what is pain?
It's really what a person saying.
Good, thank you. So pain, that's exactly right. This is what the National Association for the Study of Pain said. It's an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience, which we primarily associate with tissue damage or describe in terms of such damage of bone. What that means is that you have to believe your patients. If your patient says they have pain, they have pain. It's because it's an experience. It's an emotional and it's a sensory experience. I can't tell you, well, you don't have pain. You don't look like you have pain. Well, I mean, who am I? How can we measure pain if they don't tell us? It's a very qualitative marker. So we must believe our patients. Why am I saying this? Why is it important to believe the patients? Keep the trust is important, but we also have those patients that we call druggies or drug seekers, and those are usually the ones that do not get proper pain management. And so we need to really, we have to evaluate the social situation, but we maybe really have to address the pain issues. And we're gonna talk about that a little bit later. So how do we evaluate and assess pain? Okay, so we have the OPQRST. O stands for onset of pain. P stands for what provokes or palliates the pain. Q stands for quality, so classification of pain, OPQ. R stands for radiation, so where does it radiate? S stands for severity. And T is time pattern. So there you have it, OPQRST. And that way you will never forget anything about pain. And you have this in your handout. Pain scales. We have to give a number to a number of some sort of measurement of what the type of pain and the amount of pain that our patients are feeling. And they have developed different pain scales. We have three different ones here. They are actually in your, if you look at your pain card that I showed you this morning, the one that is long and opens like that, we put this on the pain scale in case you forget. But you can also show to your patients. So from, let me just show this pay card to people that didn't come this morning. This page here is a colorful page. I don't like the colors, but I don't know. I don't know who chose them. Okay. Anyway, so this is the first page. If you fold it in half, the first page is pain management card. And on the third page of your pain card, there is a scale there, which is very useful for you to, in case you want to show your patients. So you put this very nicely on your lab coat, and then you use it. It goes from 0 to 10, basically 0, no pain, and then the worst pain ever. The one behavior facial scale was developed for pediatric patients. We use this one very much these days, particularly for patients that do not speak English. Because it's very common. If you see the happy face, obviously they don't have pain. If you see a sad face, they have pain. So that's very useful. And then is the activity tolerance scale, in which does the pain interfere with their activities of daily living and their functional status. So those are three different scales that you could use. But you have to have a measurement. I'm sure Jacob, you are familiar with Jacob, right?
Yeah.
They mandate that we have a pain assessment scale set up on the system, and I'm sure you do have it. It's just the way to, the way of using it, which sometimes is controversial. So we need to make sure that we have a scale set up in our system. So what are we seeking on Grandpa Miguel? Well, we wanted to achieve comfort with minimal side effects. The guy is confused. The guy is agitated, and he seems to be in pain because he's moaning. So we need to achieve comfort. We need to restore function because this guy was very functional, right? This guy used to play bingo, this guy used to have a girlfriend, and this guy seemed to be pretty on his own. So we need to restore function as fully as possible. We want to maintain patient's autonomy, dignity, and cognitive capacity. We want to provide relative freedom from pain, and we want to relieve pain-associated anxiety and depression. This is a World Health Organization three steps ladder. And they have three different steps. When this scale, when this ladder came became available to everybody, what happened was that somebody would show up with pain 10 out of 10, cancer pain, and they would try Tylenol and say, well, let's see how it works. Well, that's not gonna be very helpful. And so what the way that we use this World Organization scale that for physicians, by the way, this is gonna be also on your board, is that if somebody has severe pain, we immediately go to severe, which is level 3. So if you look at this, for mild pain, we have aspirin, which we don't really use a lot for pain control because of the side effects. Tylenol, I want you to remember Tylenol is an excellent medication in the elderly. It's excellent, it doesn't have a lot of side effects. The only thing you have to be aware of is liver toxicity. You cannot give more than 3 grams a day for older adults or patients with liver failure, and no more than 4 grams if you have patients who have a quote-unquote normal liver. Our veterans, we have to watch out because many of our veterans have some damage due to alcohol or hepatitis, so be aware of that. NSAIDs are very good medicines for bony pain, but bony pain or muscle pain is very good, but be aware that they can have kidney effects, side effects, as well as GI side effects, stomach problems. And we can use other adjuvants here. Other adjuvants, you probably have heard of gabapentin, you probably have heard of nortriptyline, you probably have heard of SSRIs. We use them, and those are called coadjuvants. So they're not really first line, but we use them together with some other medication. For palliative pain, we're talking about pain 5 and above, 5 to 7, 8, some sort, which is interfering somewhat with the functional status of the patient. And those are what we call the weak opiates. So you probably have Vicodin or Percocet or those medications which are a combination of Tylenol and Colid. Be aware, this is what the nurses at my units do. So they give Tylenol and they give Vicodin at the same time. Remember. This has Tylenol and this has Tylenol. So you could put them into toxicity, so be aware of that. But again, this is a combination, and it has a low dose of codeine, hydrocodone, or oxycodone, or dihydrocodone, and they're all usually given every 4 hours. Now, you could only have seen that these medications may be ordered Q8 hours or Q6 hours. The problem with that is that the half-life of our opioids will not cover you more than 4 hours. So if you prescribe these medicines, please prescribe them every 4 hours, not every 6 or 8 hours, because that's just going to leave your patients with a couple of hours of pain. There's tramadol here, which I don't use a lot, but in general, it has demonstrated to be a good medicine. Be aware of delirium in the elderly. And then severe pain. For severe pain, we use the opioids, the strong opioids or morphine-like medications. And here we have hydromorphone, a commercial name is Dilaudid. Methadone, which I want you to be very careful with methadone, because methadone is a long-acting opioid. What that means is that it has a very half-life, very long half-life, excuse me, and in the elderly, it tends to hang around for a long time. So if you have a patient on methadone with an older adult who may have some liver or kidney problems, and they're being not controlled, and you increase the dose of methadone, please do not increase it every 24 hours, because then you're going to have to use your naloxone. I'm talking about for overdose of opioids. So methadone is something to be very careful about. If you need to titrate your medicines, morphine or hydromorphine are probably the way to go until you're able to control pain. We have other forms of medication, fentanyl, which is the pretty much the only medicine that we have available in patch. And it's a good medicine for people who cannot take oral medications. So for example, we have a lot of patients with head and neck cancer whose pain is controlled with fentanyl patch. I have to tell you, it's more expensive than the rest of the medications, so your pharmacy may give you a hard time with it, or the community hospital may give you a hard time with it. So you have to justify the use. One of the things that I need you to remember is on your pain card, on the last part of your pain card, the last page, you have a table. And that table has the equivalences of all opioids. The only thing you need to know by memory is that 1 milligram of IV morphine is equivalent to 3 milligrams of PO morphine. That's the only thing you need to remember. Other than that, in any exam that you take, even the palliative care boards, they're going to give you an equivalency table. So don't worry about it. But I do need you to remember this. I need you to remember that you always prescribe a continuous dose and a breakthrough dose, always. What that means is that you need to deliver a medication around the clock and then a breakthrough medicine in case your patient has further pain. So this is what it says here. For continuous pain medication, are best given on a regular around the clock basis, and additional doses may be required before activity is known to exacerbate pain. So if you know your patient's going to go to physical therapy, you may want to give them an extra dose of medicine. And this is different from the regular dose that they're at. Any questions about that? Yes? Is that tumor fever? No. The controversy that was between fever and the fentanyl patch was the fact that patients were sweating and the absorption wasn't completely indicated. In terms of tumor fever, no. You need to control the tumor fever just to make your patient feel better. But once that's controlled, you can use the fentanyl patch. Now, thank you for bringing back the fentanyl patch, because something else that you need to think about is when you use a fentanyl patch, you need to allow 24 hours for the patch to work. So if you put the fentanyl patch, say I put 25 micrograms of fentanyl patch, and the next day your patient is complaining of pain, don't increase the patch, because the patch hasn't had time to work. So you need to put the patch, give the patient some short-acting morphine for 24 hours, and then wait to see what the patch is doing for the patient. Now the patch lasts 72 hours, and remember, if your patient is sweating, if your patient has some sort of procedure that required skin contact, or if they were, that's a good one, they had a surgery and they were cleansed in surgery, the patch is not going to work. So anything that interferes with skin will interfere with absorption. Any questions about that? I don't want to give you a crash course in pain management. Hopefully, when you get to San Antonio in that week of intensive training, we'll be able to go over pain management. But this is just kind of the main points that I wanted to remember.
Can you give too much fentanyl?
Yeah, it's a lot. Okay.
Oh, I mean to control pain.
Right.
Is there a max dose?
Oh, well, thank you. Okay. There is a maximum dose for Tylenol or acetaminophen. But opioids do not have a maximum dose. So I have prescribed 2,000 milligrams of morphine every 2 hours. And
not the fentanyl.
And fentanyl, as many patches as can, you know, fit in your body. Sometimes, you know, when I get to more than six patches, you usually want to switch that to something else because it's, you know, it's just it's too much, you know. But yeah, there's no limit on the dose that you give for opioids because as long as the patients do not have side effects, important side effects, you need to control the pain. So, and that's the work question. Anyway, so non-opioid treatment. So we talk about Tylenol and good pain medication, but there's toxic to a liver. We talk about NSAIDs, and about the fact that they could cause GI and renal side effects. When I start controlling, and I'm talking about older adults or very frail patients, when I start controlling pain with opioids, I usually, and this is my preference, I start with short-acting opioids. The reason is, if you start a patient directly on long-acting opioids, you're not going to be able to titrate that up as quickly as you should, especially in older adults, and you're going to encounter side effects. So what I usually tend to do is I start them on short-acting opioids, and then once I have a stable dose, I transfer that into long-acting presentations of opioids. For the short-acting opioids, your dose has to be Q4 hours. So let's talk about this. The maximum peak side effect of morphine is 6 minutes. The maximum, and that's for IV morphine. The maximum peak effect for PO morphine is 1 hour, so 6 minutes, 60 minutes, just for you to remember. So in theory, you could give morphine every 15 minutes IV to control your pain if you have a pain crisis. Now, nurses, are you gonna like to give morphine every 15 minutes?
No.
Yeah, I think so. That's probably not possible. So we usually prescribe those every 4 hours. Which still covers the half-life of the medication. Is that clear? But don't prescribe every 6 hours or every 8 hours or every 12 hours if it's an immediate release. Why? Right. That's right. The patient is going to be in pain for 10 hours. So not good. Now, we need to adjust the dose daily. How do we adjust the dose daily? We calculate the whole amount of medication that the patient had received in 24 hours. We calculate, we also ask the patient to evaluate their pain, and if their score of pain is 4 or higher, we increase the dose. So for mild to moderate pain, we increase the dose 25 to 50% of the total daily dose. For severe uncontrolled pain, we increase the dose 50 to 100% of the total daily dose. So you always have to look at your requirements from the day before. Is that clear? And of course, if you have severe uncontrolled pain and a patient who is moaning and suffering from this pain, you have to adjust this more quickly. So you're going to have to reevaluate that throughout the day. These are the pearls that I wanted to remember. Percocet, 2 tablets, Q4 hours, which is acetaminophen and hydrocodone, is the same as morphine 1 milligram an hour IV, and is the same as fentanyl 25 milligrams patches. So those are kind of rough same equivalences for you to know. You always prescribe a standing dose and a rescue dose. That's clear, correct? Rescue dose is 10% of the daily dose. So let's say that Mr. Miguel received, in order to control his pain, we're going to give him 100 milligrams of morphine IV. What would be the rescue dose of this patient? What?
So 10.
So you would say 10 milligrams Q1 hour or Q2 hours PRN, right? Mm-hmm. And that's on top of the regular studying dose. Mm-hmm. Now, this is a very tricky one that I want you to remember. Say that Mr. Miguel, say that we run out of morphine in the hospital. And so we're gonna switch from morphine to dilaudid, or to hydromorphone. So in order to switch from, why don't we do that? That's good. Okay, so why don't we switch? Tell me how many milligrams of hydromorphone is Mr. Miguel gonna require? Just go ahead and take your pain card and he's receiving 100 milligrams of morphine and his pain is well controlled on that. So how many milligrams of dilaudid would he require? Dilaudid is hydromorphone. You just go to your table.
So what, 15?
Well,
he said 50%, 7.5.
7.5. He's run out of morphine in the hospital.
And that was good.
And Mr. Miguel is taking 100 milligrams of morphine IV a day. And we need to switch that to hydromorphine. How do you come up with that number? You know I'm going to ask that. What's that?
1.5 milligrams of hydromorphone is equivalent to 10 milligrams of morphine.
Excellent. Good. Everybody agree with that? Anybody disagree? Good. Okay, so this is the trick. You are right. The equivalence is complete. However, in order to prevent cross-tolerance, which means other adverse effects from a new opioid who has not been introduced to this patient, we decrease the dose 50% for cross-tolerance. So instead of giving him 15 milligrams, we will give him 7.5 or 8 milligrams of hydromorphone. Is that clear? This is to avoid cross-tolerance. Now, some people are going to tell you adjust 30%. Some people are going to tell you adjust 25%. In the elderly, the rule is 50. So you decrease the dose by 50%. Any questions about that? Okay, and we talked about this morphine peak for IV is 6 minutes and PO is 60 minutes. So those, if you remember this from this lecture, I'm very happy. Opioids, side effects. So what's the main side effect of opioids?
Constipation.
Very good. Well, you read very well. So what is the side effects that never ever goes away in opioids? Good, constipation. Yeah, constipation. What is other people going to tell you the main side effect of opioids is? Other people that are not as knowledgeable as you are. What are they going to tell you? Respiratory depression. Yeah. Oh, I'm not going to prescribe morphine because they are going to have respiratory depression. I'm going to have to use naloxone. Right? And the answer is no. Okay? The answer is the main side effect that always goes there and never goes away is constipation. Okay? Now, very important, when you prescribe an opioid, you prescribe a bowel regimen. So tell me a good bowel regimen.
Surfactant,
colloids, right, don't say. So what does that do?
Keeps it moist and keeps it moving.
Good. Well, colloids is actually a stool softener. Oh, I'm sorry, don't say. It's a stool softener, right? But the problem with having that is that we have a lot of soft stool into a lot of bowels. If you remember, we have meters and meters of bowel stuff inside us. So we gotta keep moving it. So we have to prescribe two agents. We have to prescribe a stool softener and we have to prescribe a procinetic, anything you like. In San Antonio, we just happen to have the cheapest stuff, which is docusane and Senna, and that works pretty good. Somebody used to tell me that if you don't do that, it's like having mush without a push. So I hope you remember that. So always, you have docusane and you have Senna. And on the second page of your pain card, there is a list of bowel regimens that you can use. Any prokinetic and any stool softener will do. The hand that prescribes the opioid is the hand that will prescribe the bowel regimen. Otherwise, it would be the hand that will disimpact the patient. Believe it or not, I'm exaggerating on constipation. I really hope you remember this. I have seen patients that we have taken to the operating room to manually have to disimpact them. I've actually opened the belly and squeezed their bowels out because we haven't been able to do that. It's absolutely horrendous. I ended up having colostomies. So I'm not exaggerating. When you prescribe opioids, chances are that you're going to get very constipated. So just remember that. Any questions about that? Good. Nausea and vomiting, they are very common. And this is not an allergy. So this is unbelievable because all my residents tell me, oh, my patient is allergic to morphine. What kind of reaction they get? Oh, they got very nauseous. Well, that's not an allergy. It's a reaction, and it's normal. It goes away 48 hours after. So you need to educate your patients and your other colleagues about this. Nausea and vomiting is something which is normal, but it will go away within 48 hours. Delirium. So this is a good one. We're going to stop all morphine-like medications because the patient is confused. What do you think about that?
Wrong.
Correct. Because delirium is mainly caused by the pain. It's not really caused by medications. I am not saying that that one of the reasons may be morphine-like medications or opioids, but I'm saying that it's most likely that the delirium is caused by pain. So that wouldn't be the first step you take in order when you have a delirious patient. Rash and itchiness, again, this is not an allergic reaction. This is just a side effect. It goes away within 48 hours. Dizziness and somnolence, respiratory depression. Those two go together. Every time you have a patient with respiratory depression, the patient was asleep the day before. Always, always. If you have a somnolent patient, be aware because the next step is respiratory depression. So, but it never happens that the patients are awake and talking to you and suddenly they broke that because of respiratory depression. That's just not gonna happen. So it goes slowly. That's why opioids are very safe. You just have to watch side effects and know about this. And dependence. Everybody who is going to take opioids, any opioids, is going to be dependent on the medication. Now, does it mean that the patient is going to be drug addicts?
No.
So what is dependence?
You have to have more than the same pain.
So you have to have certain, right, so, excuse me. So you have to have certain dose in order for you not to experience symptoms. Have you seen patients on drugs, heroin withdrawal? So what do? They get the shakes, they get very red, irritated, agitated, aggressive, right? They have nausea and vomiting, and those are the same side effects that our patient with morphine withdrawal would experience. So when you are prescribing morphine or any opioid for any matter, you need to decrease the dose slowly before, you need to taper it down before you stop the medicine cold turkey. This is what I see on my surgeries. My patient get a hip fracture and they have a morphine pump and the next day they are Tylenol. And so my patients are shaking and they're delirious and my ortho guys go, well, why? Well, of course, you know, you need to know that even 24 hours in contact with opioids is gonna make you have some withdrawal. So you need to taper that slowly. So what are the treating options for our side effects? We have a prophylactic bowel regimen we talked about. Fluid intake is very important. You prescribe a bowel stimulant, and then you prescribe a stool softener. You could treat mild sedation, severe nausea, and the pruritus. If you have myoclonus, that is an adverse reaction, and you could decrease the dose, or you could change opioid, because that is a sign of cross tolerance. And then we have to titrate slowly. So if somebody who have not seen opioids, you need to start low and go slow. And that's the rule in geriatrics as well. So these are just different definitions. Tolerance is when opioid that we prescribe lose its effectiveness and require higher doses to produce the same analgesic effect, I'm sorry. You have to think about when you have a tolerance reaction, the first thing you have to think about is that your disease has progressed. Maybe your tumor has increased, maybe your tumor is invading your spinal cord and that's why the pain is more. But if that's not the case and you prove that by test, then you can actually either increase the dose or switch to another opioid. Physical dependence we talked about is when the body adapts to the opioid and then withdrawal symptoms may occur. And addiction are cravings for the opioid and continue use despite repeating harmful consequences. This is, for example, when my patient steals their wife's car to go and buy morphine off the market. This is when a patient hits you in the clinic because you are not prescribing enough morphine. you have to know this because your patients are going to ask you. The first thing that most of my patients ask me is, am I going to get a drug, you know, addicted to this medicine? And I can tell them that less than 1% of the patients get addicted to it. So it's a very, very little number for the benefits that we can get. But addiction requires an aggressive behavior with harmful consequences. Please avoid these medicines in the elderly. Demerol, neperidine is a no-no to use in the elderly. It has a very toxic metabolite that hangs around for a long time and produces seizures in the elderly and delirium. Propoxyphen had also had the same long-acting problem, and medicines such as pentazocine, butorphanol, and nalbuphine has. But if anything you remember Demerol, because our doctors love to use Demerol. Demerol and Bistro used to be a big one. I don't know still, but yeah. So other adjuvant analgesics, we have the antidepressants that we talked about. We use it, for example, to neuropathic pains, which is gabapentin. And bone restorative agents in osteoporosis or acute fractures, we have seen that myocalcin is very useful sometimes. We have to remember the non-pharmacological management. So patient education, to know that their pain is not going to go away, maybe go from 6 to 3 and that's good, to let them know that the idea of us controlling the pain is that they continue with their lives. We need to give them cognitive behavioral strategies, relaxation techniques, chiropractic, acupuncture may be available, different massages, biofeedback, exercise, surgery, and radiotherapy sometimes could contribute to cancer pain. So those are options that are available, and we shouldn't be close to those options because we're in this traditional medical field. If patient has chronic pain, we need to be open to whatever can help them. But education is a big deal. So again, this is just a cue for pain management. So you assess the patients, you use the LPQRST. We have to inspect the pain side. We have to be realistic. What's the patient's goal? Assessing the pain here. Any other alternatives? You reassess according to the pain method used, and please, you document. Remember, it's not okay to have pain. It should be addressed by us. Our patients will not tell us they have pain. Pain should be treated regardless of the cause, and there's no reason for making our patients suffer. So now we're going to continue with our case. And because we all became experts in pain assessment and management, we assessed the pain, and you decided an adequate pain management regimen. And the patient seems slightly improved. He was admitted to the orthopedic team, and a medicine consult was obtained to clear him for surgery. They ordered some antihypertensives. He underwent hip surgery. And during surgery, the patient was found to have bone lesions suggested of metastatic cancer. Otherwise, the surgery was uneventful. After the surgery, Mr. Miguel was very agitated with incoherent speech. Restraints were ordered, and a geriatrics and palliative care consult was requested. In the meantime, the medical team is pursuing a differential diagnosis for malignancy. As a palliative care healthcare practitioner, you review the patient's chart and notice disorders that hold all pain medicines due to confusion. What do you think? Terrible. Absolutely not. Terrible, yeah. On physical exam, you know that Mr. Miguel is short of breath, pulse of 682, his wrist strain has an NG tube and a Foley catheter in place. He's restless and agitated, I wonder why. And he's unable to state his name. Patient has a respiratory rate of 30. So now we are dealing with delirium and we're dealing with shortness of breath. And Margaret Carter is going to tell us a little bit about non-pain symptoms.
There are several, when you're talking about patients, palliative care patients, patients in pain, there's a whole array of non-pain symptoms. But for Miguel, in this scenario, we're going to limit that to delirium and dyspnea. So now let's see if I can... If I want to flip it, do I just hit?
Here, you can just push or a little button.
Oh, all right, good. So when you review the literature, over and over again, they talk about differentiating between delirium, dementia, and depression. Delirium is a confused state. It's very an acute onset, and it's fluctuating. Their awareness is reduced, and you've got a lot of psychomotor agitation. And we've all seen that. Now, with Grandpa Miguel, when we look at the initial data from his outpatient visit, we see that he had an MMSE of 21 over 30. So on a good day, he had a baseline moderate dementia. And you can always have a delirium that's overriding a baseline dementia. These little folks that do have some decrease in cognitive status, some cognitive impairment, they do fine in their own environment. But let them get sick, take them to surgery, put them in a hospital bed, all of that familiarity is gone, and the cognitive impairment really shows. And then on top of that, we're adding pain. Depression, we just need to continually assess for that, because untreated depression can make a dementia worse, appear worse, and it just complicates the whole scenario. So it's good just to remember those three things. Incidentally, you know, I don't want to belabor this, you know, we need to get through a lot of material, but it's really better if we keep this informal, and if anybody has a comment or something you'd like to add, please feel free. Okay, so now we need prevention. There is we do have the ability to be a little bit proactive. When we see somebody like Miguel coming into our unit, we can almost anticipate some delirium and have a high index of suspicion and help avoid help avoid things that may cause this. We did have a baseline cognitive screen on this gentleman. You know, you may not always have it, but you might be able to gather a little history if he does have family around. Listen for hallucinations and paranoid speech is very common. And, you know, I've noticed with some of these folks, the elderly that do have some dementia, if they hallucinate, frequently they'll tell you that they're seeing children playing. And I actually read an article, you know, I thought it was just me, but I did read something about that. I had an 89-year-old man come in, and we just ended up treating depression, and he got a little bit better, and he said his hallucinations are gone. I said, are the kids still there? He said, no, but I sure do miss them. It wasn't frightening to him. He realized they weren't really there, but he was seeing them. And then we want to continually continually watch the patient for signs of infection. Miguel came to us with 102 temperature. We don't know post-op, but we need to look at him seriously for infectious process going on. Okay, causes. The hospice palliative care people use these little mnemonics to help us just be comprehensive in our assessments. So if we're looking at dementia, the first thing we have to, or if we're looking at delirium, the first thing we have to do is look at the medications. And I gave you a list. It was an article that I found online, and it's a list of medicines that can potentiate delirium. It's almost everything that we use. So it's kind of a double-edged sword with medications, but this is a good time to have pharmacy come and help you look at medications and see if there's anything there that might be contributing. We're not treating pain. We need to get his pain treated. So I think that there's really not much to eliminate. His pre-op medicines really don't look that too remarkable, I don't believe. Liver failure, hepatic encephalopathy. People can develop. Now, Miguel's had an alcohol history in the past. We're not sure how much, but liver failure, liver disease is always a possibility there. He's definitely hypoxic, so that is a symptom that needs to be further investigated. Renal failure, we need to do a chemistry and double check his liver and his renal functions. Again, impaction, everything that's been done up to this point and laying in the shower for 2 days, I'm sure did not help. Everything that's going to happen to this patient is going to contribute to constipation and potential fecal impaction. And it sounds like such a basic thing. At work, they call me the constipation queen, but I'm telling you, you can save the patient and yourself a lot of heartache if you can monitor bowels and keep that working well. Urinary tract infections are easy to treat and very common. And then we have to consider, we know he had a bone lesion, and so suggestive of metastasis, he could have metastasis to the brain as well. When I looked at this, I thought, you know, he had a fall. You don't know, he said in his outpatient record that he fell before, so you don't know how many falls he's had or how many times he's bumped his head. So we just, it's remote, but we need to keep that in the back of our mind. Okay, other things that we need to think about is alcohol withdrawal. I used to work on a cardiovascular unit down at BAMC, and we get people that would go to surgery for bypass or whatever, and come back and be in alcohol withdrawal. Well, they never really tell you exactly how much they were drinking to begin with. So, you know, a few days without it, and you just always have to keep that in the back of your mind as well. And then we've already talked about underlying brain disease and loss, cognitive loss. Sensory impairment, if they've got visual impairment or hearing. And even people that have hearing impairment on a good day have a hard time if they're not hearing you, if they're not understanding what's going on and what's going on in their environment. Just a couple of other things. Delirium's prevalent in advanced cancer. And 42% of the people that come to hospice and palliative care will have or have had some episodes of delirium. It's very common in post-op patients, and the highest post-op incident is after hip fracture. So Miguel was kind of falling into that category. Also, with low hemoglobin and hematocrit, we don't know, we need to check a CBC, but have a decreased oxygen carrying capacity, and that can contribute to mental status changes. And then Dr. Sanchez-Reilly has already talked about untreated pain, but it's a very complex relationship between pain control and delirium. So, also sleep deprivation and immobility, and he is immobile. He has restraints, he has an NG tube, he has a Foley. So if you can get rid of those as soon as possible, you know, and get him up in a chair, if you can do that safely, those are all positive things. One little just incidental about Foley catheters, if you can get rid of them, great, but you have to watch your patient for urinary retention. With all of these drugs and everything, sometimes they do help. As much as I hate to admit it, sometimes Foley caths are a positive thing. Okay, treatment. Basically, we're going to treat the underlying cause. And actually, that slide, instead of just saying opioid toxicity, it should just be drug toxicity, because we give our patients lots of drugs, digoxin, seizure medicines. A lot of drugs need to be followed with levels, so we need to check those. And we've talked about polypharmacy sepsis. It looks like he was dehydrated when he came in, but post-op now, we're going to have to look at his fluid and electrolytes, because you don't know how much fluid he had. We don't know by the scenario how much fluid he had in surgery, so we need to look at that. And then we know he's hypoxic already. Okay, pharmaceutical treatment of delirium is pretty simple. We don't have any magic bullets. Haldol is mentioned over and over again in the literature as first line, as a very low dose, 0.5 to 1 milligram of Haldol can be used. And I found a very good article, and it just said it doesn't really eliminate the delirium, but it will decrease the frequency and the severity. Some of the newer atypical antipsychotics, risperidone, olanzapine, or quetiapine are used frequently. Haldol has a kind of a quicker onset and a shorter half-life, but you run the risk of the extrapyramidal symptoms, so you have to monitor them and watch very carefully. The atypicals sometimes can cause a little hypotension if you're not careful. There is a manufacturer warning out about the atypicals now, that about putting patients at high risk for cardiovascular events like stroke. So there's a little controversy there, but
they're used, and as long as patients are monitored carefully, we're good. Benzodiazepines, the short-acting lorazepam, is usually the one that we use and is mentioned most frequently. And there again, we need to be very careful because overdosing can contribute to the delirium, but the sedating effect sometimes can help relax the patient and get them through this period. Okay, then the non-pharmacological treatment, there's tons. I mean, there are so many implications for nursing and medicine, actually. Hydration and nutrition for comfort. Whatever that patient wants, we want to try to get them orally hydrated if we can. A lot of times they'll do better with small, frequent, those little 4-ounce cups, and anybody can walk in and give them a sip, and naturally you can get quite a bit of fluid in them if you can get them to eat. Mobility as appropriate. You know, we need to, and Miguel, we need to get rid of these restraints. We need to take the MG tube out if we can. Get him up in a chair and then walking as soon as orthopedic says that he can be weight-bearing. He's going to be fall risk, so we need falls precautions. We need to reorient him and observe him. Make sure that he gets adequate sleep and rest. Okay. It's kind of where, you know, medicine and nursing are arts and sciences. And in this patient, it's where the art of those two professions, especially where you're ordering and administering medication, it's where the art comes in and where the individual treatment of the patient really makes a big difference. Okay. So that's delirium quickly. Okay, so now, sorry,